at every state. New institutions, industrialization, global imports, rampant capitalism and corruption were changing India, or we can read it, Indian subcontinent, and though the myths persisted, were modified and increasingly seemed to be fantasy or escapism. Popular cinema in India is still a kind of escapism. People compare film critics like there is Chennai Express and then there is Madras Cafe, and which movie earns the money. So one movie which takes you into an illusion, into an escapism from the reality like Chennai Express, then it will be in the club of 300 crore rupees, whereas Madras Cafe will be struggling to earn a little bit of money also. The task then for the new cinema and the South Asian writing was to distance oneself from the myth and describe and dissect the personalities and possibilities of existence that emerge. How many of our writers are doing this? How many of our filmmakers are? It is not that nobody is doing. They are. Brave attempts are made by writers also. Brave attempts are made by the filmmakers also. But how do the culture respond? How do the society respond to that? That also is an important part of the observation. Indeed, obviously, Terry Eagleton do come and surface, like people argue that why do you politicize literature, post-colonial aspect, or the contemporary reading of the literature is more colored with the political kind of a thing. Well, we find an answer in Terry Eagleton when he says that there is no need to drag politics into literary theory. It has already been there from the beginning. We were not seeing earlier. Now we have started looking at the things that are already there. Earlier it was not perceived by us. Now perhaps we are able to perceive those things. This should not surprise for anybody of theory concerned with human meaning, value, language, feeling and experience will inevitably engage with broader, deeper beliefs about the nature of human individuals and societies. Problems of power and sexuality, interpretations of past history, versions of the present and the hopes for the future. Interpretations of past histories, which is a very much necessary part of a thing, where the trauma or memory novel plays a very vital role, and versions of the present and the hopes for the future are always remains. Dipesh Chakravarti's article is quite interesting so far as this narrative or memory novel is concerned. He also says that trauma is the memory, and as Madam has already talked about this, I do not throw more light on the same thing. It will be a kind of repetition. So we see now a kind of an overview, bird's eye view over some of the selected texts that came in the recent past from the South Asian countries. Well, Bhutan, if you see, then we come across writings like Headwind, Lakshmi's Story, by Alice Anna Verheje. And what is the theme of this writing? The struggle of a refugee child growing within the constraint wall of socially and culturally conservative society. And the basic idea is Nepal, Bhutan insurgency. Nepalese were thrown out of Bhutan by the monarchy and they came towards India also, but India also was not ready to help them, support them. And the same agony, same anxiety of the nearby borders or the nearby countries, how they happen, that is reflected in the another poem by Devi Zubedi, Exiled Agonies. Few lines of this poem. In the beautiful village, country of the thunder dragon, far in the eastern world, I was born. I was only in my fourth year of childhood, barely uttering the word of motherhood. The tyrannical government of Bhutan, in monarchical, it declared Nepal raised people as anti-nationals. And all the Nepalese were thrown out of Bhutan. And then, as he goes on writing, set the camp in Assam, northern India. Many died in starvation and malaria. The Indian CRP loaded people in the truck, did not allow to stay over. It is our bad luck. Stated Nepal is for Nepali race people, did not respect human rights. Situation was terrible. Life as a refugee is painful. Many treated as free labor. Life wasn't peaceful. For 17 years, humanism were limited to boundary. I cannot express agonies of old and sundry. All our peaceful attempts to be back to our homeland gone in vain, for India did not join our hands. Chasing us out, the government of Bhutan is not stopped, still torturing and trying to exile 100,000. And then they went to USA, Canada, Australia, New Zealand, Denmark, Netherlands, and then now the contemporary time that more than 20,000 are now in the United States, scattered in almost all cities in the new destinations, dreaming to have future generation great, but for many reasons, lot has to regret. The worst situation in the bad economic condition, all Americans themselves are in the greatest tension. No job opportunities, nowhere to go, where to go now. So this is one agony that comes in a Bhutan literature, which speaks about India on one side, Nepal on the other side, humanity on the third parameter, and how do the different countries look at the things. Nepal obviously had a kind of a past traditional writing along with India. Sanskrit was the beginning of the Nepal literature also. In their writing we find Sanskrit spiritual tradition, then we got revolutionary poets, nihilism replaced spiritual tradition, and then obviously diaspora writing also is found. There is interesting work by Govinda Raj Bhattar Rais, who is masterpiece, Sukrat Paila, that is Socrates' footsteps, which was set against the time when the Maoist insurgency was at its peak. Again, Maoism, a civil war kind of situation becoming a part of a literature. There is interesting observation in the Nepalese literature where Michael Hutt has played a very vital role in revival of the past literature. Well, again, it's something like what William Jones and they were doing with Indian Sanskrit literature and rewriting of history. The same episode is found in the same piece. He has brought in Yogmaya's life in the text called Sarvatha Yogbani, and then analyzed the attempts that have been made by various activists and scholars to portray her as feminist rebel, a social reformer, and a progressive poet. So one Devi from a myth coming as with a modern way of dealing with the world, feminist rebel, social reformer, and a progressive poet. Well, there is a hand of one Westerner like Michael Hutt in the revival. Bangladesh obviously had a very, very troublesome time and that is very well reflected in their literature. As we know that when East and West Bengal was divided before independence of India, it was still a very fertile ground for literature and other activities. In Pakistan era, that is East Pakistan after 1947, by and large the literature covered up the thematic concerns, which was the problem of language, Urdu or Bangla. And Pakistan wanted Urdu as an official language of East Pakistan, and which people were not ready to accept, and there was a revolt. And the another 1971 war was also based on, as one parameter, the linguistic identities of Bangla and the Muslims of Bangladesh. So it covered up, and still in many of the writings you find that insurgency, the struggle for the owning of a language and writing about this communal, rural and urban problems. Bangladesh era, that is country comes into an existence after that war, 1971, and then liberation war, its consequences, hopeless human existence and analysis of human mind and society. Normally it has happened whether it was French Revolution or American Revolution or Russian Revolution. At the end of the revolution, revolutionaries are by and large frustrated. They fought for a cause and then they always see that the cause is not fulfilled. And then the things are going into bad hands. And the same thing was perceived in Bangladesh also. So that agony, that hopelessness of fighting for the cause of a country and then things going out of the things is also perceived in their writings. Very recently, if you see the writing, then we have Tahmima Anam. Cruelty towards those women who suffered the cruelty on the hand of insurgent militants when the country was under the strife. And then when country became their own country, then their own people are implementing that kind of trauma over those women. So they want to erase or marginalize in the search of a clean linear history, and so these people were erased, and those things were that episode comes into this novel, The Good Muslim. It is an exceptional and searching look at the hidden horrors of war and the appeal of religion in the aftermath of 1971 Bangladesh War of Liberation. There is a story of a brother and a girl. Brother stays there after the war, and girl goes abroad and becomes a doctor. She comes back and comes back to see that the brother has become a fanatic, Islamic, almost a terrorist kind of a person. But she has her own way of looking towards the brother. The Good Muslim, it gives the title that how and what happens that the people turn to become frantic so far as religiosity is concerned. The blame obviously goes to the circumstances rather than the individuals. The division is a result of Sohail's, that is the brother, fanatic devotion to and Maya, the sister, the protagonist, alienation from religion, and then there is a strife in a family regarding the religious issues. It's a part of a trilogy. First book was The Golden Gate, this is the second, and third is To Come. Well, so she is one recent contemporary writers to be looked upon when we look towards Bangladesh and its representation into the literature. But then this walls you will always find. There is a wall between brother and sister here. This narrow domestic walls, they are not crumbling down metaphorically in literature and politically on the maps also. Sri Lanka, we have an interesting work by Shehan Karuna Tilak. The name of the work is Chinaman. Full title is Chinaman, The Legend of Pradeep Mathew. And Pradeep Mathew is a spin bowler who has mysteriously disappeared. On his quest to find his unsung genius, WG, that is another character, who is a drunkard and an old fellow out of the sports arena, good for nothing kind of a fellow, but his hero once upon a time was Pradeep Mathew, and he was suddenly lost. And this drunkard old fellow goes in search of that spinner, Pradeep Mathew, and the story is unfolding in this. So in the quest to find the unsung genius, WG uncovers a coach with six fingers, a secret bunker below a famous stadium, a Tamil tiger warlord, and startling truths about Sri Lanka cricket and himself. And we are dragged into this LTTE, Tamil tigers, and civil war of 1980s in Sri Lanka. So again, Jaffna as the Tamil area and the rest of the Swahili, and the conflict between Tamil and Swahili in Sri Lanka, the narrow domestic walls clearly surfaces. And the metaphor here is cricket. Obviously, it gives a very good post-colonial reading also. And it's an interesting read from Sri Lanka. Another work from Sri Lanka is Island of a Thousand Mirrors by Naomi Munawira. And she explores how women in Sri Lanka on opposite sides of the civil war negotiate the realities of life. Attempts to transcend a little more than 60 years of history, the violent and strife-torn decades of post-colonial Sri Lanka through three generations of two families, and one lady in one family has been molested by Tamil tigers, and then she was forced to join the Tamil tigers, and she becomes a part of the Tamil tigers militant group. Here also there is a family who goes abroad, and then they come with a new vision back to their own country, and then compare and contrast. So time and again we find in this contemporary writing that the characters go to West and then they come back. Whether it's Tahnima in Bangladesh or Naomi in Sri Lanka, in both the narratives we find that there is a part of a family still going to the West, coming back and re-evaluating their own country, their culture, their conditions. And obviously in that we still perceive the narrow domestic walls that stand very strong. In Pakistan, we have, and obviously many of the writings along with the Reluctant Fundamentalist by Mohsin Hamid and Thing, 9/11 played a very vital role in the Pakistani creative writers' consciousness, and they obviously tried to present their side of the 9/11 trauma and the people, the Asians who were living in America, and how they have undergone the kind of an anguish. So city where origin matters less than the talent, New York, three Matrosthenes. It's a quite interesting word that he gives here. Three Matrosthenes have the guts to claim the place as their own. But after 9/11, things go horribly wrong. Suddenly they find themselves in a changed America. Making the logical leap from dualities to multiplicities ponders New York's reputation as the proverbial melting pot of peoples and culture. Has New York or America still remained that proverbial melting pot of cultures and people, or now there are the walls for the different cultures and the people? A blotted sense of self-importance. Obviously, this is an interesting remark that I found by Meera Hashmi in one of the reviews of this book. This blotted sense of, which is quite true of most of the South Asian writing also. It should be pointed out that, for the most part, it sidesteps the pitfalls of over-earnestness and sentimentality that are the hallmarks of a lot of new South Asian literature. Self-pity. One has to come out of self-pity in one of the... Self-pity is one part of the South Asian literature, that we pity ourselves a lot. And then we compare the kind of thing. And this literature also has the same kind of a thing. The another work by Mohsin Hamid is the recent one, How to Get Filthy Rich in Rising Asia. And it also again speaks about the Asian countries and the thing. Well, again here the metaphor is a self-help book, and the narrative style is also of a self-help book. We have Arvind Adiga, The White Tiger, also almost in a similar pattern, a kind of a self-help book. So how to be a better entrepreneur? You read Balaram Bhalwai's story and you learn about that. And here it is, kind of the story. Shows what it means to get rich in a rising Asia in a new novel at a time when the developing economies in the region are straining to push up their GDP figures. Mr. Pant, one of our government officials in inauguration of the SAARC event, he said that South Asian countries are running for their GDP, economical growth and different things. He says first stability perhaps is necessary part, then the growing of a GDP. And in GDP and then there is happiness index, they do not match well. And he gave an example that Bhutan is a country where GDP is not much higher, but then the happiness index of Bhutan is much better than the countries like India or the other one where there is more happy country. A nameless city in South Asia that sizzles with energy, opportunity and inequality. Touches upon new South Asian realities, broken hearts, failed marriages, culture of corruption, politics, lifestyle pressures on fast street, and the perennial near war edge that Pakistan balances on. So no name of a city, no name of a character, but then it can be any city in South Asia, it can be anybody in South Asia, and the story goes on with a kind of a mirroring of image of failed marriages, broken hearts, corruption, politics, lifestyles, etc. A very interesting work from Pakistan is by Jamil Ahmed, and this time he takes us on the border of Afghanistan. Pakistan-Afghanistan border and the tribal people living on that border, and it's a collection of three long short stories where he deals with those people. All the three stories are connected to the story of Torbaz. The parents of Torbaz belong to the different tribes, they run everyone. Four or five age, they both are captured and they are killed by the tribal people. The atrocities of the people raised of nation states as they seek to impose artificially constructed borders on older, more fluid worlds. And another true story is like the death of camels, where there is a girl, Guljana, who is a taker of camels, and she is just passing a border, unknowing that there is a border. And she thought that I have a Quran over my head and nothing will happen to me. Suddenly there are fires and camels and the girl both are killed, and Quran or nothing comes to save them. And then the point of honor is like when Torbaz's parents were butchered, the Baluch rebel, they thought that they will be praised and they will be given awards, but then they were captured and they were also killed by the another tribal people. He critiques the ruthless way of bordering countries. The tribal people, they don't know that from where the another country begins, they normally have the rituals like marriage or any of the thing among the people nearby villages, not knowing that this is another country. You cannot help the person on the other side of the border, you become a kind of a person with a charge of treason or other kind of a thing. But then they live in a borderless fluidity of the world where they do not have borders between their lifestyles, their living things. Suddenly there is a border imposed upon the outsider that now you cannot talk with your neighbors, you cannot marry your children in the neighbors, you cannot graze your camels on the other side of the pasture because that is not our country. That is suddenly now the other country. Now this, when it is done, what havoc does it bring? Jamil Ahmed very beautifully tries to capture it. Muhammad Hanif, a very comical way of writing a novel that comes here, is Our Lady of Alice Bertie. And Alice is a criminal and savior. There is a contrasting thing about this character. A victim and heroine of a daft, evil little novel of comic genius. And with the story and Grizzly's Sacred Heart is the name of the hospital where this lady, Alice Bertie, is working. Be taken as a parable for Pakistan. Alice Bertie belongs to a Dalit kind of a community in Sikh, which is living on the other side of Punjab, that is in Pakistan. And the father is a sweeper, and they are converted to Christianity, so you have Alice Bertie. The name is the Christian, the surname is the Pakistani, and she works in a hospital which is one of the most horrible places to work. And the narration goes that every day a lady dies in the hospital.